podcast with Professor John Anoche is made possible by partners of John Anoche Ministries. Still to come on Word of Life with Professor John Anoche.
Dreams and interpretation is a gift and a grace God gives to people. A young Joseph, but he was sold into Egypt bondage. And as a servant or a slave, he became the prime minister. And that accounts for the grace of God. That it doesn't matter the kind of family you come from. God can make you a prime minister of the family. You can come from a family of witches and wizards. But God can make you somebody greater. It depends on your disciplines. Remember the guy. A woman just opened herself up. Joseph just looked at it and said, bye. For Joseph to see all this. How many young men today?
When we talk about Assyria, all of you will understand what Assyria is about. When I say name a city in Assyria, at least you'll be able to name one or two or three cities in Assyria. The same way the other places and other topics that we have treated. But I want us to consider today the Egyptian Empire or the Egyptian Kingdom. The Egyptian Kingdom. One of the vibrant and interesting kingdoms that ever existed in the world. And usually people talk about Egyptian civilization. You've heard it. Egyptian civilization. And where the Egyptian pyramids, Egyptian culture and all that, and power and all those things are talked about. And you can read about Egyptian Empire or Egyptian Kingdom. You will notice something. But we want to talk about the Bible's account. Okay? It's good to have some kind of knowledge about a topic that is in the Bible, especially the historic, you know. If people are trying to disprove the Bible and have not disproved the writings of archaeologists and ancient Greek mythologists and scholars of all kinds of literature, then they cannot, because it's linked to whatever the Bible says and all that. Then you cannot disprove the potency of the Bible. Because when you go digging and searching for such knowledge, you see them there. You see them there, that there existed an empire called Egyptian Empire or Kingdom, where there were the pharaohs. The landmark is there. There were features in the Bible that the scholars also record, and they are there. There have been a lot of archaeological findings that proves the existence actually of this kingdom or empire. So sometimes people want to make bold statements regardless of all these proofs to authenticate, you know, because they are trying to challenge, you know, the potency of the Word of God, the Scriptures, or the Bible. These are the stories of the Bible. But if you want to learn, you have to dig deeper and go deeper so that you can learn well. That is why I'm just touching on these simple things, and so we can have understanding. Sometimes Christians, we feel that these things are not necessary. Teach us about Christ, and that's it. You know, and everything is about Christ. Why would God hand over the entire Bible to us? When Jesus was on earth, Jesus himself ministering, and we see that he made a lot of quotations, and he picked all the quotations from the books of the scriptures that were already written by prophets and in the law and Psalms, right? Except you are not a Bible student and you have not bothered to go back and infer. Even the word of God that says that man shall not live by bread alone, it was a quote from the book of Deuteronomy. There were several scriptures that Jesus Christ referred them to. He referred to the fathers. He referred to Abraham. Jesus spoke about Satan. And anything that he spoke about, that means they are there. He spoke about the Pharisees. If Jesus hadn't spoken about them, perhaps they would not be popular like that. Today in our Christendom, the Pharisees are very popular. I'm sure they will be popular than even the real Christians in the church. Because in every church, we have Pharisees. We have Pharisees. We have what? Sadducees. Amen. Yeah. So that is what. Yeah. So when it comes to the what authenticates the Bible, there are a lot of natural and physical things. You know? A lot of materials that professors and scholars have written in centuries that authenticate the word of God, the Bible. So I want us to go into the Bible, Genesis chapter 10. Let's read something there, because the kingdom of the empire of Egypt. And it looks as if that everything started from after, you know, all the dispensation we are living is after Noah. After Noah. All right. The reason why I thought about Canaan or Cain and Canaan. So I thought about Cain, then I thought about Canaan. It was because of the transition from their era and how the spirits entered into the era of Noah, his season, because God ended that kind of season. That session was ended. But so 8 people crossed over. Clean people. No sin. How come atrocity started again? Wars started again. Sin started again. You, let's say that Cain and all that came to mist. They missed that. There was something called mysteries in the Bible. So they missed. So they started being stubborn. He knew how to kill people and all that. But what about after the flood? Now Noah's children were righteous and their wives. Nobody was sinful. Everybody was obedient under Noah. And Noah was called righteous people, righteous man. He found favor with his household. So all of them were righteous people. Imagine a prophet's home. So Satan didn't have a chance, right? He didn't have a chance. A devil, Kadabashata. He's a liar. But the guy managed to get into their home. So if I don't teach it and make people to understand what those things in the Bible mean, okay, we will not understand the depth of God. How deep God is when he speaks. We'll take it literal like that. As though God is one of a human being. So he uses his terms that are different from our terminology. So I prompt you so that in actual fact, the Bible is supposed to be explained correctly. So you don't have to word. So people must not say there's no point. It doesn't point to Christ. It points to Christ. Because you see, if you were serious enough to dig deeper, you would have seen that everything points to Christ. Everything God started doing, trusted human being that they will be able to do for him, they failed. That's why there was a need for someone to come from heaven who will be adopted to, like, as Abraham's son, as David's son, who will die. It will make you appreciate Jesus more. God tried with all the Adamic sons, all the men that were sinful nature, they all failed. None of them. And that's why the Bible said there was none that was righteous. That was the statement that was made. There's none that was righteous. None. But in our dispensation, if you say there's none that is righteous, you have insulted Jesus. You have insulted the race of Jesus. We are all under the race of Jesus. There have been races, seeds, There are several seeds in the earth realm. Satan has his own seed. The Adamic nature has his own seed. The worldly people don't accept Jesus. And then we have the seed also of what? Demons. We have seed of Christ. We are of the seed of Christ. So there are several races and we are of the seed of Christ. So how come God did not get anybody on earth? He tried. He tried people. So after selecting Noah, the righteous son, a righteous man with his children, then the devil infiltrated. It also gives you some kind of knowledge and skill and gives you advantage, okay, so that you'll not be ignorant of the devices of the devil, how he manipulates things. That's it. So how come a man of God, a prophet that God speaks to, and he has children and a wife, and the devil doesn't fear to get there? The devil was not afraid to get into that place. It was not a foreigner coming into the place. It was his own son and his own wife. I studied the Bible carefully and I wanted to find out wives of men of God. And you don't see, apart from Abraham, maybe Isaac, you don't really see wives of men of God listed in the Bible like that. This is Elisha's wife. This is, like, you don't see that. You don't see it. It's not common like that in the Bible. Why? Even the ones you see. I was trying to look at Abraham's wife, our Papa Abraham's wife. And it's very dangerous trying to talk about the woman of God, our mother, like that. But it got to a point where there was an argument between her and God. God said, you said this, I didn't say it. You said it, I didn't say it. But she said it. The issue was that, God was not standing in front of her because God had come in the flesh. So she considered that one as maybe a prophet. And when I speak to myself, you don't need to hear. And if you claim you have heard, I have my will. I can say you have not heard it. You have to understand her position. Not that she knew that this is God, though. No. Is the scripture painting the picture for you to know that that was God? But it was after he had left that it was revealed to Abraham that was God who took a form and came. You read the scripture, you think that he just knew that, God is coming to visit me. So everybody would have cleaned the house. If God has said, even has said, you have a big head. Yes, sir. So it's a test of faith issue. So when you read the Bible, paint the right picture and put yourself in, so you don't miss the revelation. That's what I just want to make you understand. All right? There was an argument. I didn't say it. You said it. Today we have such in the church where they are not bold to sell, like to just, be bold to speak the truth, to tell the truth, because they think their dignity is at hand. But your dignity in the realms of God, in the realms of the sea, before God, is what you must ensure that, it's not dented. Because if you said it and you said, didn't say it, God has written it that you have lied. To me, I will conclude, okay, maybe she didn't say it, but you said it. So you become unpopular before God, but popular before men. Which one is good? When you think I have lied and I say sorry, can you publish it? Even if you publish it, is it written on me? There are many people who have done atrocity. It was published, still we just accepted them. Thank you, my Father. So there are certain things we must know in scripture when we read, so that we paint the right picture for people to understand. Now let's go into the book of Genesis chapter number 10, verse number 6.
The sons of Ham were Cush, Mizraim, Put, and Canaan.
So the sons of Ham were
Cush.
Cush.
Mizraim.
Mizraim.
Put. And Put. Canaan.
Put and what?
Canaan.
Canaan. Now, the translation of Put is Libya. It's Libya. The translation of Cush is black. So when they gave birth to you, what was on you is what they named you of. And then Mizraim, they had different colors. They were men and people of color. And then the last one was Canaan. So that means that this Ham guy had already given birth to his children. Then the last one was Canaan. And he got out of his tent and went to visit his mother. And what happened, If you have not really, read that side and you have not understood, you have to go to Facebook, YouTube. Go to YouTube and type Prophet John Anoche. And then the message. So you go through the messages, you see the mystery of the Bible, Canaan. Then you can listen to the part one, part two, and then get yourself acquainted with that message and that knowledge. Amen. So everything is connected. So if I'm teaching, everything comes. So if you don't know from the beginning, you will not be able to understand me the first time you hear from me or you hear of my word. Now, the sons of Ham were Cush. Cush means black. Mizraim. And then Put. And Put is Libya. It means a bow. And then Canaan. Now my concentration here will not be Cush. Because one person gave birth to Cush. And Cush gave birth to Nimrod. And then all the kingdoms and the things that we have seen in the world. Trying to have dominion over everybody. And building Babylon and everything. Now, the second person that he gave birth to was Mizraim. And his son Mizraim is the same thing as Egypt. And this guy also had empire. So it's like this guy, they're like, all his children are becoming what? So that means that the devil had a kind of association and covenant with them. Because he allowed himself to be dominated. And he passed on to his children. So there's terminology in our local dialect that says, "Efie bia mensahom," meaning there is the third man in everybody's what? Home. Everybody's family. When I say third man, that's how I've explained. Mensa means third man. So, in quote, I've used the third man in quote. Though the second man will be good, first man will be good, but the third man is opposite both of them and the family's principles and values. So, when the family is going right, it's going left, extreme left. Amen. So, understand this one. Where did Asher come from?
Asher is Assyria.
Now, Asher is Assyria, but who gave birth to Asher?
Cush.
Okay. So, you see, and Cush is Cush's father is Ham. So, you see where the thing is coming from? Okay, good. Let's see something. Then we have Mizraim. And the Mizraim is what I want us to talk about today. That's what I want us to talk about briefly today. Because I don't have much time, but I will be able to talk about it briefly so that next week, by the grace of God, I will continue. So when the Bible talks about Mizraim, or Mizraim, it's Mitzrim, Mizraim. The Hebrew people pronounce it like it's Mitsrayim. It's like they always say Nim, Mitzrayim. Or Mitzrayim. The phonetic is like that. Mitzrayim. It means double streets. It means double streets. Double streets. A country at the northeastern section of Africa, adjacent to Palestine, and through which the Nile flows. And that is the recorded history about it. They have the upper and the lower Egypt. So simply put, when we talk about Mizraim, we are talking about Egypt. And the father of Egypt is Ham. The father of Egypt is Ham. And he gave birth to these strong boys. Cush, Mizraim, Put, and Canaan. And all his sons are the ones who started all these things. One building a kingdom called Babel and God coming down to confuse them and all that. I just want you to understand. And there's nothing new under the sun, as, you know, Solomon said. And Solomon was given the wisdom to understand the things of the earth and everything about the universe, except that he could not understand everything. Because Jesus Christ is the perfecter of everything. So Jesus came with the fullness of knowledge. That is why Jesus said, a greater than Solomon is here. So you see, the Bible has records of this. So if somebody is writing, a scholar is writing some things about it in 18th century, 17th century, or 16th century, like 15th or 14th, 12th, whatever century that he wrote it, when you read it, you will see there's a connection of it. Okay. So why are people in our day trying to disprove these things? That even the ancient people, the Bible is older than anybody who is on earth now. So it is extremely difficult for you that something is older than you, far older than even your great-great-grandfathers, to disprove them. Something that has established a whole nation. The whole nation Israel is established on the principle of the word of God. So it's not easy to just disprove them. It's only that the people themselves are false. And they want false members or false people, false followers. So they've not gotten people. You see, you can't be looking through a book to prove the authentic nature of a particular word. A particular, let me put for a better word, religion. Well, Christianity is a life. But for the purpose of, you know, studies, and for them to understand. Because Christianity as a religion and it's a life, has an experience. It's just as somebody worshiping Satan. They are able to prove the existence of their God, their master, because of the experience. So a book says that when you enchant at this time around, you will get this spirit and they do it and get it. When you kill your father, you will get this and they do it and get it. So it is an experience. So people who have repented come to say, oh, this is what we went through. Now, what makes you think that Christianity has nothing like that? So Christianity also has experiences. So you see, so you can't be a Christian without the experiences of a Christian. You cannot be a Christian, a proper Christian. You cannot be a Christian. You cannot be, a Christian without the life of Christ. It cannot be. So if you are a Christian and you have the life of Christ, you must have the experiences of Christ. And the experiences of Christ is supernatural. Now the tongues we speak, they try to mock it, but they cannot perpetually speak the same thing that we do. Why? Because our own is by inspiration. That means it's by unknown source. That means a source you cannot touch, untangible. The tongues we speak is from a higher dimension. They don't know the source. The Bible said, the Holy Ghost said, the world cannot know me. They cannot see me. They cannot know me. Therefore, they will not like me. So everything about the Holy Ghost, the world will mock. The gift of the Holy Ghost, the world will mock. The demonstrations of the Holy Spirit, the world will mock. The power of the Spirit of God, the manifestations of the power, the world will mock. When they mock, you see that we are worried. We shouldn't be. Jesus told us they cannot see the Holy Ghost. They cannot know him because the Holy Ghost is not for them. And the Holy Ghost is the Spirit of truth. Their father is the Spirit of lies. It cannot be that they will understand you. So don't worry when the world is, you know, coming against you based on your faith. Hallelujah. But when they are coming against you based on your faith, they are introducing to you their faith. That is the double standard life. So if you don't stand on your ground, they are rather uprooting you from your own grounds and introducing another thing for you. I just need you to understand the word of God and what Jesus has said to us. He said, the spirit of truth that is coming, the world cannot know, so he cannot agree. They cannot do anything about it because they don't know him, neither have they seen him. That's the point. So everything about him, they will disprove it They mock tongues, they mock all the manifestations. But we don't care about it. We just have to do it more. Amen? Hallelujah. Because of this, sometimes when people, especially in the corporate world, when people accompany people to church, they don't want their friends to know that they speak in tongues. Are you speaking tongues? Yes. Karabatoskepeka. It is not their kind of religion where they go in the night and they go in the midnight and they don't want anybody to see them. And they go and do, they go and do and drink blood. Our own is plain. Amen? That's why they can say we have burned your gathering because it's visible. But their gathering is not visible. It's in the dark. You can't say, if the president says I've burned the dark world, how is he going to monitor it? Which soldiers is he going to use? Amen? That's the point. Are you hearing the point now? Good. Thank you, Jesus. So what makes us spiritual is the giftings of the Spirit of God. So we have to engage that a lot. So that is not, you know, where I want to go. So let's go into the chapter 30, the verse number 13. So chapter 10, verse 6. I just read a bit of the sons and where Mizraim was highlighted. So if you want to talk about the empire of Egypt, if you don't refer to this part, you will not be able to understand because all of them have a source. And the Bible has recorded where they came from. Where they came from. So let's go. So from the sixth verse, then he started talking about Cush. He spoke about Cush, all the sons of Cush. And then he took the sons of Cush. He took the ones that did something. So he said the sons of Cush were Seba, Havilah, Sabta, Rama, Sabteka. The sons of Rama were Sheba and Dedan. Cush begat Nimrod. He's already mentioned the sons he begat earlier. But Cush begat Nimrod. And he began to be a mighty hunter. So because he extensively did some things on earth. So they are, the Bible is trying to, you know, single him out. Because he did something remarkable. Whether good or bad, he did something. So the Bible is trying to single him out. So that's when, so the Bible also came from the land he went to Assyria and built what? Rehoboth Air. And that's what the Bible says. And Rezin between Nineveh and Calah. That is the principal city. So Mizraim also, when he came to Mizraim, he said, Mizraim begot Ludim, Anamim, Lehabim, Naphtuhim, Patrusim, Kaslihim, from whom came the Philistines and the Kaphtorim. Now all these people that he mentioned, are they there? The nations you are mentioning their names, Philistines, are they there? Okay, they are there. Some of them, Nineveh and all that, they've changed their names. All right, so they are there. So from these two cities, he says, from these two cities came Philistines. All right, but Mizraim begot people. So Mizraim was a man, and he begot people. And the Bible didn't bring their wives; they married before bringing those children. So the Bible started, you know, going. So from Ham, he went to, you know, so he started with Japhet. He went to Ham. He now went to Shem. So Shem is where Abraham came from. Abraham. So Mizraim, this is Mizraim now. All right. So when we have to read the Bible and know about the kingdom of Egypt, we all know in the book of Genesis, in the time that the Egypt kingdom was the superpower and they were trying to buy slaves all around the world. And they were the superpower, so you did not go to touch them. You know, at a point they started going from one city, one nation to another and beating everybody and you becoming slave and paying homage to them. And that's how the kingdom spread. That's how any empire or kingdom spread. That's how they spread. So in the Bible, it's recorded how they also did the same thing to a lot of cities and nations. For Israelites, they did not capture them, but they went of their own accord. Now, because they sold their deliverer into slavery, into the hands of the Egyptians. So by that singular act, they sold themselves into the Assyrians. So when you read the Bible carefully and the prophet, you see that God was talking about the fact that I bought you, he said, with the ransom. So the Israelites coming from Egypt, they were bought. Because the Israelites, the Egyptians, bought Joseph. And Joseph happened to be the one at the time chosen as the leader of their family, of the entire dispensation of the Israelites, which is Jacob's children. And the Israelites are the embodiment of Jacob's children. Because Jacob died and all his children were still Israelites. Or the Hebrew people, that's what they call them. But Israelite is popular. Because that was the name God gave him from heaven. So I just want you to understand it. So when you start reading the Bible, you see those kind of things there. That they were powerful, buying slaves, and they were building their kingdoms. Mightily building their kingdoms. And their source is Ham. That's their father. And the father of Ham is Noah, the prophet, a righteous man. But how come all his children were doing things and all atrocity and evil stuff came from them? How come? So if Abraham's children went into Egypt, it was their uncle. Are you hearing the point? So in the dispensation, generations after, it was their uncle they were going into. So hear this one. Karabashatahaya. All of them were not worshipping. Because initially when they all came from the ark, they were all supposed to worship God. But you see, everybody scattered to just raise their own families. So with time, they forgot God. But one did not forget God. So God chose that family, of which Abraham is the one that was chosen, to serve him and his children to serve him. And so he had a covenant with them, and God calls it a marriage covenant with them. And so in the Bible, he's used this marriage, you know, symbol as a kind of covenant with them. And so with time, they also, they deserted God and went a whoring. But there were other people there. Then the reason why God would choose one person is because you will talk about it today, that why would God choose one particular family? Because God has already seen their future. That even if I choose this one, they will still not worship me. They will be so stubborn to the point where I have taken them to even heaven gate. That is where they will rebel. So God sees. You see, God is not like you. He sees the end from the beginning. So he chooses based on what he knows. So when you can't say somebody is all-knowing, I will not know your end. So before God will choose somebody that you'll be the one to worship me and serve me, he knows you'll be obedient to death. Like the matter, somebody will ask a question. What if one of them decide I will not do it? You see, before God chose somebody to be a martyr, he knows that he would be the end of it. He saw them. You see, that is why the prophet has prophesied and has listed all of them before, because their end is listed. So that question must not come into a Christian's mind at all, because if you know God, that question is answered. It's answered by the definition of God. God sits like this and see your beginning and your end together. So when he's choosing all the people here, he knows the one who steal this mother's meat, go here, do incest here, and all. He knows up to the end. So he knows that this guy, if I choose this guy, because I've given their will to them, I don't control their will. But there come a guy who always asks God, if there's God somewhere, guide me. God, the one of my father, God, guide me. So he's talking about the God of Abraham. Guide me, guide me. So God knows that this guy has been talking about God. So I need to guide him. The same way, God chose two people from the womb. And Paul was trying to explain that because of the foreknowledge of God, he knew the foreknowledge is the advanced. No, God knows them advanced, what they will become. He knew that Esau, this guy, will choose the jackals of the mountains over his father's dynasty or his father's spiritual empire. So he will use the anointing for that purpose. So let me stir the heart of the mother to help Jacob get the anointing, even though Jacob is called a supplanter. I want you to understand something. So it's not about God was not fair. No, the fairness of God is based on who he is as God. So, you human being, you are his clay. You cannot judge him because he knows your end. He knows the life. You see, it's like God is someone who has manufactured a car and writes the lifespan of the car. He knows when this car will break down. When? Exactly 10 years to come, this car will break down. So this car cannot carry me to Canaanland. But he made another car that can carry him beyond Canaanland. So he chose that car. Then you judge him that why have you chosen that car? The maker of the car has the right to choose the one he wants to travel with. Because he knows the lifespan of those cars. That's why they are expensive cars. They are, you know, that's the point. That's why you see people on earth and they have only one angel with them. You see other people, two angels. You see other people, thousands of angels, one person follow him. How? That is why obedience, as you are a Christian, is the key. Obedience. Obedience is the key. Once you have your own questions and you have your own mindset, you are too big for God to guide. Too big. And God will never, you will never see God appear and say, my daughter, I'm guiding you, my son. No, he will always guide you through his men. He's called them servants. But sometimes you think you are wiser. You see, they are servants of God, so it places them in the stead of God. So when they say go here, it's God telling them for you. Because if you go and you fail, it will be on them. And the name of God is, you know, so it will be God. If they are truly servants of God. So I just want you to understand these things. All right? So that's how come, you know, the family became like that. And in Egypt, you know, where at the time their kingdom was based on civilization, education. Their kingdom was based on education. Their kingdom was based on knowledge, scientific research and know-how. So they called them the Egyptian civilization. They started manufacturing artifacts and explaining the mysteries of their discoveries with writings and terminologies and those kind of artifacts they were doing. So when you saw artifacts that were sitting in their temples, it explained the kind of discoveries that they had made. It's an interesting topic, I'm telling you. Egypt is... And they started to bring all sections of people who were speaking different kinds of languages with their cultures and embrace them. But you'll be a servant in that place. And royals could visit them and all that. They don't care about it. And trade with them. So they opened the Egyptian market to a foreign world. Trade, international trade. So they were trading. So the place became popular. But the Pharaoh was the god. Because he had a lot of gods. They had the sun god. They began to research about sun, moon, all the other things, elements, the water kingdom, everything. So it was like, how was it necessary for them to know all these things? And everything they researched on, they made a god out of them. They made a god out of them. And you talk about the Egyptian army. You talk about the way they did their captains. You talk about today the Egyptian pyramid is being used in even in modern civilization with, you know, with the Freemason and all that. It's the Egyptian pyramid. It has been there. So they've adopted it and talking about modern civilization. And these are the people who are the Illuminati. That means they are more enlightened. That is what they want to see. In their own eyes, they are more enlightened. And the Christians have not bothered to know these things. So when somebody comes and trying to divert the Christendom into another thing, the Christians will not be able to, by their spirit, pick up some things. Because the Spirit of God also dwells on knowledge. To let you understand. So he uses symbols to make you understand. So maybe you had a vision. Remember, I was watching somebody on TV, on social media. At that time, I didn't have a TV. But I was watching somebody who was coming to create a religion. And he would deceive the people until the end when they would see that this is who he is. So I was watching him on my phone on social media. because the person is making daring statement against Christians and the Bible, and he's trying to use the Bible to disprove the Bible. Then as I was just watching that, and I prayed, like I was very angry about it, but I prayed. And I was just laughing. I said, this guy, he's joking. You know, he's just having these things with people who don't have deep, they don't have depth in the Word of God and all that. They've read books. Yes, it's true, but there has to be, they have to go deeper and make references with the books to the Word of God. But that was not a combination. So when I watched this guy, I saw a tree like this, very tall, mighty tree. And he came from the tree. I saw myself around the tree, that I was just watching something. The Lord was telling me to watch, just stay focused and watch. Then I saw the guy come out of the tree. Then I told him, ah, but you are not correct. How come you are deceiving the people? Then he laughed and said, prophet, that is how the thing is. That's how the thing, that's how it goes. That's how it goes. That's how it goes, you know. So the tree sent you. I looked at the tree and saw that the tree is a tree of knowledge of good and evil. And the tree of knowledge of good and evil is what Satan embraced for himself. Because he used that tree to get to man and corrupt the nature of God that was in the earthworm. So, if that is the case, and someone is coming from the same place, must you listen to the person? You see, so if I didn't know some things and I just saw the tree, I would just interpret it my own way. Oh, the guy, he's a herbalist. He's a herbalist. You know? I will just read the Bible, go and look for, and then maybe I will just see some trees in the book of Isaiah and Ezekiel and say, oh, I think he was coming from one of these trees, so he's good. So I'll tell my people that, oh, that guy, what he's saying makes sense. So people will start following him. They speak against, oh, the offerings Christians give. Look at him when he started. And look at him today, you see the difference. And he also has mobile numbers and everything. He calling for offering. It's whether it's donation, whatever, it's a type of offering. Because you are sealing the covenant he has with whoever that sent him. Like, and I know people are not. But that's what I saw. So I shared with my people so they know that this is the case. That the Lord Jesus spoke about it, that In the end of times, all those people will just come and sway the people off. These are the false teachers and the false prophets. Do you think somebody who is false against, why would Jesus say somebody is false? False because Jesus is the right, and he knows he's the right one. So all his people are the right ones. So other people will come and try to sway them off to their own, and he calls them false. That's the point. So if you're a Christian and you're trying to also have different knowledge of the scriptures of God, you are false. He never said when someone is doing miracle in Jesus' name is false. He never said that. But they've made you to believe that one rather and leave these ones who are rather false. So when we read the scriptures, we need to go deeper to understand what the scripture says about certain situations and events. And I always want to infer from what the Word of God has said concerning a particular topic or knowledge, something, so that we can discuss. It's very, very important. So in my next, teaching on Egyptian empire, we will go deeper to understand the composition of their empire. Now, I want Apostle to read a bit for me in the book of Isaiah chapter number 19. Let him start from the verse number 12, the verse number 1 to the verse number 25. Thank you, Father. Kabado Shihata. All we know is, oh, Egypt, the Egyptians that you see today, you see no more. Then we are clapping our hands and praying. They have a source. All right? Why would the Bible make a bold statement that when Jesus was born and he was pursued, the angel appeared to Joseph and told him that let the lad and the mother go and hide a place that I've prepared for them. In Egypt, why would the place of Egypt be a refuge for them? God wants to sustain Joseph there were other nations there, even though they were not empire. Empire means like a combination of nations together who have one ruler. There were other nations that he could have gone to live there, and God would have made them great. Why was there a need for him to go to Egypt? Because everything about God is planned. He knew everything before. And the guy himself had visions where he saw himself, you know, as a greater man than his brethren. And so they started persecuting and sold him off. And the finality of the selling went into Egypt. The finality of the sales went to Egypt. And so when they wanted food, they had to come to Egypt for the food, because the one they sold is the one that carries the food. But God had already spoken to Abraham about it, that, but your sons, your generation, they will be there for what? Over 400 years in bondage in what? In Egypt. But initially when they went, they didn't go as people were going to be under bondage. They went there for greener pasture. And their son was the one who was what? Even the prime minister. He was second to the Pharaoh. And he was the one who built the scientific knowledge of food production and food storage. For somebody to be able to store food for 7 years, he has to have a scientific know-how of preservation. So this guy got prophetic revelations about preservation. He was a dreamer. He could dream that somebody was going out of prison and the person would go. He could dream that somebody was... And all the dreams were symbols. People could tell him their dreams, which are symbols, and he would just interpret the dreams. Whichever way they had it, he went to somebody carrying something and bears are eating, he's able to interpret it. My father, thank you, Lord. That means dreams and interpretation is a gift and a grace God gives to people. But he was sold into Egypt, bondage. And as a servant or a slave, he became the prime minister. And that accounts for the grace of God. That it doesn't matter the kind of family you come from, God can make you a prime minister of the family. You can come from a family of witches and wizards. You understand? High court witches and wizards. But God can make you somebody greater. It depends on your disciplines. Remember the guy. A woman just opened herself up and did a step like this. And started, you know, Sadducees. Joseph just looked at it and said, bye. I watched a video of a man of God who was saying something like, I think he was teaching or something, I don't know, but he was very aggressive. Kiss! He said, kiss you or something like that. He said, Bema, no, why no? He, Obe, kiss you. He said, relax. It's a people's wedding. He said, Obi, I call Jim 3 days ago. How many young men today, a young Joseph, she saw Potiphar's wife, one of the elegant women at the time. You know, the Egyptian women, like there were some people who were soaking their bodies with spices. So when a bypass, you could smell. I'm talking about civilization. At that time, all the people of the world were in Krasifo villages. They had a civilization. If you wanted to be civil, that was the place you came to. It's like everybody's trying to go to America or UK. UK crowd, they would prepare some more civilized. The shoe will be 1975, Washa 2002. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
They'll not teach you how to spend. America will teach you how to spend. You see the kind of things they are pressing. Yeah, Master, why? If we are saying India, be out there. Amen? Yeah. Don't you see it? Yeah. When I watch the US people and I see our president, Independence Day, like 6 March, once I'm a bomb in San Jose, especially the swearing in. This swearing was the fastest one that I've ever witnessed. In the past, you see, Ponko, you know, baby, a chesser. then the president is suffering. This time they've simplified it. When you see the Americans, one, the chief justice is standing here, standing there, some glass small one, me, I do, sir. They simplify it. When they are done, then they showcase their power. See their president with cars, the lighting system, the flash torches, the security. You see them, they will just, the camera is in the air, showing the people are standing in the air, and everybody is, ready, alert. But masa, just, yeah. You, when you are a nation, you see it, when you are watching, you call your commander-in-chief and say, Kweku, be very careful, you don't go and insult them. Praise God. Hallelujah. Yeah. So we're talking about civilization. That was the place. And for Joseph to see all this. Every woman is a woman though. Yes. And yeah, that's a statement of fact. Every woman is a woman. Yes. But there are certain things that embellishes a woman that makes that woman extraordinary woman. Civilization. So we are not talking about some kind of somebody who came from, let me not use a name that the chiefs will say you have used our name in vain. Let me use some name somewhere. You came from some village somewhere beyond the rivers of Ethiopia. And the ladies there, when you go there and they say, choose any virgin you want, you might not choose any. Because when they are coming, they say they are coming. The way they talk, hey, black, won't you choose me? Won't you choose me? So perhaps you are thinking in your mind that was the kind of woman because you're talking about ancient Egypt. No, my friend. Potiphar's wife, we are talking about. He stands before the king, the Pharaoh. They play with water. That means they were neat. They bath all the time. They have jacuzzi at the time. Oh, yes. I'm talking about civilization that through which people learn a lot of things. They learn paintings and all that. Look at that. And they sold paintings, very expensive. Sculptured articles. Artifacts. And this woman say, hi, Joseph. This is a scholarship for you. And Joseph said, what? And Joseph too, he looked muscle like money pakao. So pakao is a pakao. So when Joseph was called, Joseph, honey, says, was coming.
Yes, madam.
He said, so he thought Joseph was just a fool. Said, Joseph, I'm offering you your boss's precious jewel. And Joseph said, away. He didn't explain anything. Away. How many men today? There was a price. So he was not just interpreting visions and dreams because he was just dining and whining with it, Today people think, the grace is what matters. The last time Apostle was telling me something, I told him, Master, this is foolishness. This is where I get when I get into that. So, when you do that, you'll be falling into temptation. Listen, there's no one. You see, everybody, the Lord knows that people have weaknesses. There are certain weaknesses. When you see some people, you will know that this one, it cannot be weakness. It's not possible. Do you understand me? Oh, it's not. When you come and see my face cry, your weakness will turn into your strength. Amen? Yeah, man. And say, it's not easy. Is the anointing is separated from the human being? Listen, it's not. So you can be just doing and then still you're anointed. It's a lie. You can't be healing like that. You can't be doing that kind of level of stuff. No, it's not possible. You will come down. We'll be perform. And that's a fact. I know a lot of men of God, priests who have come to see me and they are falling like that. And they want revival because they've seen things change drastically. They can't come up again. They have faces, all right. It's not working. They pray, healed. Now healing comes. When they want their headache to go, headache, go! Headache say, I'm still there. So you can't be engaging in that. Somebody's wife and still go like that. No, it's not possible. So Joseph knew and understood the implication. There was no law, written law, that don't touch somebody's wife. There was no law like that. It was just a custom and tradition and usage by Joseph that their father had passed on to him. From Abraham to Isaac, Isaac to Jacob, Jacob to Joseph. That was it. And the guy was not there. There was no book like today. We have a book instructing what God has said. But the guy wouldn't dare. Today, you would do it and say, let God have mercy on me. After all, I'm a human. No, you have to flee. Tell yourself, flee. And if you are a woman too, you have to flee. Because you don't know whether God has... You see, a lot of times, people that God has placed above, the ones who are trying to seduce you like that, those are the ones who get you to fall. You would have been greater and much greater than them. You don't know your future. What you see is much greater than what you are seeing currently. That is his current status. But your own tomorrow is greater than his own. But he just entices you with his, your today's stuff, which is supposed to be a step for you. Then he entices you and then you go into it. Then you trade what God has given you to them. And that's it. Honestly. So when we talk about Egypt, Joseph went and how he overcame the principalities of Egypt. All the tests of Egypt for him to have a testimony in Egypt. So much so that the brethren had to come and his father also had to come. And all of them had to come and see him as a king. And he sustained them even when the 7 years famine was over. And when it was over, they didn't tell him, you are no longer a prime minister. No. The guy continued his work, structured Egypt. So he was the one who structured. So Joseph understand governance. So all the sons of Joseph, when you meet them, even in our dispensation, they understand governance. They understand structure. They understand administration. They understand order. They understand all those things. The Egyptian civilization. The guy structured it for them. The guy did a lot of things. He touched a lot of things for them. Because God allowed it. If you people don't love him, you don't love your own breadwinner, I will give the breadwinner to your enemies, but you will go there and be a slave to pay for you selling him off. So now when God wanted the Israelite back, he had to buy them off with a ransom. That's what the scripture says that. So when you read the prophetic books and you don't understand, that is what it means. In there, that is what it means. So I just want to encourage you that once you're on the right path, encourage yourself. Don't let anybody tell you, as for today, you don't get anybody who is living well. You are lying. Yeah. It's a lie.
It's a lie.
You will not get who anybody. There are people who will not do that. So as for today, you will not get anybody. You will not. You get so many people who are living righteous, who are practicing righteous life. Practicing righteousness. They will not touch anybody's wife. They will not do that. They will not trick people's daughters. They will not. Thank you, my Father. So my time is up. Amen. So next week we will continue and then I will show you the civilization of the Egyptian Empire. Then from there, I come to the Babylonian Empire and the kingdom that came from the Babylonian Empire or the kingdoms. So you can understand the Babylonian kingdoms. Because in the Babylonian kingdoms, they are there, so we are reading. I wanted Apostle to read the scripture, but next week we'll read it. But when you go home, I talked about Isaiah 19 from the verse 1 to 25. Read it. Okay? I just wanted to give you this prophetic from the prophetic book of Isaiah. Read it and you will understand. Amen. Yeah. Thank you. Begin to thank God now. Thank you, Jesus. Begin to thank God. Thank God. Bless his holy name.
We trust you've enjoyed today's broadcast. For more information, visit www.johnanochiministries.org, www.worldwideworldministries.org, or call 0302-507-154 or 0540-996-670. This broadcast is made possible by partners of John Anoche Ministries.